Happy morning, children. Hope you all are doing good. And you completed your periodic assessment. And we are going to start with the classes. Okay. In the last class of the same chapter, People as Resource, we have seen how we can be considered people as a resource. Because just a population, how can we consider, you know, as a resource? And then what are the, you know, the economic activities and non-economic activities we have seen, and what's the difference between market activities and the non-market activities also we have seen, organized sector and unorganized sector also we have seen. Yes or no, children? Okay. So hope you all understood those concepts, and today we are going to see about the qualities of population. Okay. So we understood that, you know, the investment on the human being is very much important. Human capital is very much important. Creation of human capital. So what are the qualities can describe the human, other people as a resource? That we are going to see today. So in the last class only I have given you people the brief introduction about that. So what are those things, children? Yes. Very good. So the basic, you know, the qualities which determine a population as, you know, the qualities of population, that is education, yes, and then health, and then the skills of that particular person. Okay, in today's class we'll be seeing about, see, the quality of, you know, the qualities of population. In that, the two criteria we'll be seeing, that is education and the health. Okay, and then we'll go for recapitulation. So coming to the education in our country, because we know that we are, you know, high in population, so how can we consider, you know, how can we apply this education facility, how we are providing the education facilities to the all the people of the country, or the citizen of the country, that, you know, the entire population. And then what are the measures we are taking to provide the educational facilities? Because earlier and all we know that the literacy rate coming to India was quite lesser. And even now it is not even in all the states, literacy rate. So it is uneven. Compared to Kerala and some other states like Bihar, you know, the literacy rate is very less. So what are the reasons, or what are the measures we can, you know, take to improve or provide the best educational facilities to all the people of the country? And then coming to health. So health is most important factor that will only shows the well-being of a person. That means whether that person is capable of doing that particular work or not. Okay. So how we are, you know, providing the healthcare facilities to the all the population of the country, or all the people of the country, that we'll be seeing today. Okay. Yes, children. So the first thing we are going to see about education. So coming to the education, we have seen there are, you know, the two persons story in the, you know, the beginning of this chapter only. One it is about Sakal, and the one more it is about Vilas. But coming to Sakal story, what happens? Sakal studied well and he took some vocational courses, and he, you know, the computer course he did well, and he joined the private sector and he started to get, you know, the good earnings, and his standard of living improved a lot. But coming to the Vilas, his education good, you know, the facilities was not there, and he was not interested towards the studies or education, and his health care was also not that much good. Okay. So this all shows that education is one of the important factor for the development of, you know, the production activity, along with that the economic growth of a country. It provides a good, you know, the contribution towards the gross domestic product of our country, GDP. Okay. When we are having the good education, of course the production will be more. Productional activities will be more. The people will be engaged more in this kind of activities, the economic activities. So that's the reason education plays a very much important role. Okay. And as we know what happens, the educated parents gives much importance towards education than compared to the uneducated parents. Okay, so that's what we have discussed in your last, you know, the session. So the more educated people tries to give the more importance for their children education, they'll be spending more for their education because they know that in future they'll be getting fruit out of that. That means the benefits out of that education. Okay? Yes, children. So that is what we have seen about Suckles and Villa's story. So we can see the Suckles, due to his education and his health care, of course, he is standing in a very good position in the society and he is earning the good livelihood. But coming to the Villas, he is struggling. Just he is selling the fish to supplement his life. Okay, just to earn his livelihood. So that's the reason we understood education plays a very much important role. Okay, see here. Education contributes towards the growth of the society and also enhances the national income, cultural richness, and increases the efficiency of governance. So as we know, children, as I told you people, what happens, you know, the skilled people and there will be unskilled people also. So who can provide, you know, the produce more things, who can provide the, you know, the more income to the country? Of course it is skilled people. Yes or no, children? So that is the reason education provides or contributes towards the growth of the country, towards the growth of the society. It may be like a, you know, the national income, or we'll consider it as a gross domestic product of a country. So that's what here they are telling, the growth of the society. Along with the growth of the society, it also enhances the national income and cultural richness. So the people will be more cultured than compared to the uneducated people, and increases the efficiency of governments. The way they look at the things, or the way they, those people handle the situation, will be better than compared to the uneducated people. Okay, so that's the reason it is very much important. And then there is provision made for providing universal access, retention, and quality in elementary education with a special emphasis on girls. So as we know in the earlier and all, what happens, children? The women or the girls did not have the right to go for schools, education, and it was quite less than compared to boys. So that is the reason, as we know, we have got some fundamental rights. So in that, right to education is also there. So the every person have got right to get education. Okay, children. So that's what they are telling, providing the universal access. That means that every child should get the basic educational facilities. And they have to retain in the schools and the quality in the elementary education. So coming to the elementary education, the quality should be good. And with the special emphasis on girls, so they started to give more importance or the facilities to the girl child. Okay, because as we know, the, you know, in a family, if there are, you know, the three kids, there are two, you know, the girls and one boy, of course, you know, earlier stage, in the earliest, you know, the situation, the people were giving much importance only for the boys' education. So that's the reason. So just to emphasize or just to give more preference to the, you know, the girls, they started with some special preference to the girls for the education. Okay, children, hope you understood right. Okay. Yes. Navodaya Vidyalaya in each district. So what do you mean by Navodaya Vidyalaya, children? So we can see in every year, you know, after your fifth standard, you will be having a one exam, Navodaya exam. It's like an entrance exam. So there were all the toppers, are the bright students. So who can just crack that entrance exam, they'll be, you know, having the facility, the free educational facility, the rural kids, till the 12th standard. Okay. So that is what they are considered as a Navodaya Vidyalaya. It is also, you know, controlled by the national, central government only. Okay. So hope you people understood about Navodaya Vidyalaya. So if they ask the question like what does Navodaya Vidyalaya, you should be able to answer that, you know, it is a, you know, the education facility will be provided for the rural bright kids. Are the, you know, the smart kids who will be, you know, the able to crack that Navodaya entrance exam. In each districts, they have started this Navodaya. And then coming to the occasional streams have been developed to equip large number of high school students with occupations related to knowledge and skills. So this vocational courses will be provided to the high school students. It's not about your just education or your curriculum or the syllabus. So they will be providing some other, you know, the skills facility to the kids. Okay. For example, if any one child is very good in painting, so they will be providing that facility, the, you know, the painting skills. Or one, you know, the child is very good in cookery, so they will be providing that, you know, the skill, or else driving, or else the one child is very good in mechanic, automobiles, so they will be providing that skill. Okay. So like that, they will be providing, you know, some vocational training to the kids, to the high school students with occupations related to knowledge and the skill. So which is related to the occupation for their job orientation. The job oriented skills and the trainings will be provided. Okay, guys, understood about the vocational course, right? Occasional education. And then the next one, it is, see, the plan outlay of on education has increased from rupees 151 crore in the first plan to rupees 3766.90 crore in the 11th plan. So we know that we'll be having a 5 years plan. So in that 5 year plan, we'll be giving some preference to the particular field. For example, it is, if it is for education, you know, we have to make sure that this many kids will be getting the education, or we'll be make sure that the, you know, the literacy rate will be increased so and so, or else coming to the agriculture, they'll be giving preference. This is what the agricultural facilities we have to provide. So like that, they will be having some, you know, the concepts or the some objectives for that particular plan, or the, that particular 5 years plan. So in that, if we compare to that educational plans or the educational, you know, the expenses has been increased from first plan to 11th plan. That means we started to give more and more importance to the educational expenditures. That means they started with the new schools, they started with the new, you know, the techniques to attract the kids towards the schools. Okay. And then, yes, the expenditure on education as a percentage of GDP rose from 0.64% in 1951 to 52 to 3.0 in 2015-16 and has remained stagnant around 3% from past few years. So here what they are telling, the expenditures started to increase. Okay, so here we understood that the plan outlay education has increased from, you know, compared to the educational expenses has been increased. So even here they are explaining that the expenditure on education compared to GDP, the percentage of GDP, okay, the gross domestic product also increases from 0.64% to 3% from 1951 to 52 and to 2015 to 2016. But it remains stagnant, that means stable, for around 3% from past few years. Compared to the past few years, you know, it is 3% stagnant. It is, yes, stable. It has not changed. Okay. So guys, we understood the expenditure on education also started to increase more and more because we started to give more importance and the preference for the education, and they started to improve the schools and the facilities which has to provide it to the children. Okay, so hope you guys understood all these concepts, right?